Hi, this is Mark and Lisa Manchester, and they have been working with Mark together. Mark was diagnosed with ALS in 2011. He was in a wheelchair by 2012. He had a PEG tube by 2013, and by 14, he was dependent on the PEG tube, the feeding tube. And then in early 15, he was trached. So from March 2015 to sometime in 2018, he was pretty much, as you put it, in a vegetative state. You couldn't move, you couldn't speak, you couldn't breathe on your own, and you couldn't eat on your own. Is that correct, Mark?
Well, I mean, I actually had surgery for the trachea in August of 2015. I was in a vegetative state even before the trach, but I had a mask 24/7 that I used. And you're right, it was about March of 2015. But it got to the point where my CO2 was getting too high. So, and the mask, well, they said the mask wasn't sufficient anymore. So, August of 2015 is when we had to make the decision, and we were trached in 2000, August 15th, 2015. Yes.
Okay, and then you started taking this supplement, and you were doing a lot of other things as well. And today, Mark is able to walk, speak, breathe, eat on his own. And so this is his story.
In 2010, I played a lot of golf. So the first thing really that I noticed, it really wasn't me, it was my dad. He's like, man, you must be getting old and weak because you're hitting the ball. I mean, I'm beginning to almost outdrive you, when I used to kill him on the drive. And then I think that culminated to actually when I was swinging the club one time, and actually the club flew out of my hand because I was having trouble with my left hand holding on to the club. And so kind of, I went to the doctor, thought I had a pinched nerve in my hand. He ruled that out. And that was in 2000, beginning of 2011, but this has been going on for 5 or 6 months. And so he referred me to a neurologist, and that was the beginning of EMGs and, nerve conductions. And, I got an initial diagnosis with ALS, or they called it probable ALS at that time. And then I went to three other doctors, and the final doctor I went to at Mayo Clinic, on 7/7, July the 7th, 2011, which was my last neurologist that I went to. He said, "Mark, you definitely, it's a definite ALS, not probable." And he said, "It's the upper and lower motor neurons involved." And at that time, just over that period of since I was swinging the golf club and having issues and falling off my horse and all kind of crazy things happening, at that time, I'd already started with foot drop, and which was within a month after being diagnosed, I was wearing AFOs. So, and the progression was really rapid. I enrolled in a clinical trial in Charlotte, Carolina Medical Center, NP001. After that was over, unfortunately, they didn't give compassionate use for medication. So, we just kind of, this was 2012, and we just kind of meandered, still trying to accept what was going on and trying to deal with the day-to-day things that were happening and trying to make sense of it and adapt as we went along. And so I guess probably a year after that went by, and I'll let Lisa discuss this more, but a friend of ours that's a naturopath doctor, doctor of naturopath, and she said, "Mark, Lisa, y'all need to really come to my office, and so I can do a cradle, see what you need. Maybe you're missing some nutrients that you need to have." And I'd had numerous blood tests, and my magnesium was always wacko magnesium, and I was having some liver issues because, they put you on Ryutec or Riazol, and then at that time too, I'd also been diagnosed with pseudobulbar effects. I was on Nudexta and all the typical ALS medicines, but it was kind of overwhelming. And so what our naturopath decided is after she did the Zyto cradle.
And what's some the other Zyto cradle? What is that?
Explain that.
It's a cradle that's hooked up. It's a software that they use to basically test your energetics and what your body needs or what it's not getting. And then she also does saliva testing and hair analysis. And we have it shipped off. And then she just looked over everything to see where we were at and how we could implement and build a foundation of some good supplements for Mark to just start rebuilding and repairing his body, especially the gut. The gut gets beat up so bad on a daily basis for anyone. But the ALS, we have found that it just really... It builds up a biofilm. I mean, everyone has a biofilm, but this, we were looking for something to just, you know, like when you're building a house, to get a good foundation and then go from there to see what else and where else that we can go to build his strength up, to see where we're at.
Yeah. And the Zyto cradle, she explained to me as an engineer, I know Lisa gave a good explanation. She said, Mark, you're an engineer. It basically is measuring the conductivity in your body. So if you're low of essential nutrients, your conductivity will be less. And so, you know, and then it goes into the software, goes into a lot of different nutrients that you need. And so that was the beginning of our supplemental and nutritional program that Lisa started. And we started off slow, as she suggested. And then, we ramped up to a handful of twice a day of different kind of things that I needed, whether they were, as Lisa said, probiotics, or because I didn't have had my gallbladder removed years ago, and I didn't realize that, you know, I needed some enzymes to digest my food properly. So I started taking digestive enzymes and probiotics and
omegas
that my body was lacking.
Greens, it's called kind vital.
Chlorophyll to help my, you know, my blood actually oxygenate better. So I noticed a big difference after a few months. I mean, well, I say a big difference. I was still progressing, but I noticed a difference in, you know, my fingernails and hair and things that we'd normally do when you were, I'm not saying I was malnutrition. I definitely wasn't, but I didn't have the proper nutrition and things, but once they balanced it out, it was a lot better. Yes.
Okay, so when were you diagnosed in 2011? At one point, were you pretty much confined to a wheelchair?
About right before Christmas of
12.
Yeah, right before Christmas of 2000. No, it was before that. Probably the summer of 2012. Mm-hmm. Yes, sorry, I'm thinking 2011, but it was 2012. I started wearing the AFOs in 2011 and wore them towards the end of 2011 and wore them up until the point where I just, you know, I was falling and tripping and had a few crashes that I ended up in the hospital. So after they evaluated me, they're like, you know, Mark, you're a fall hazard. We really need you into the wheelchair. And so they sized me out for that. And the ALS Association did loan me one until my new wheelchair came in. And from then on, I was bound to the wheelchair. It got to where I couldn't, you know, I could not stand.
Right. And then what was the point, Lisa, when did he stop being able to transfer? Like, I know it's a big deal when you can transfer. When did you have to get the Hoyle lift?
Oh, wow. That's really pulling some numbers out of my head. 2014?
End of 2013, 2014 is when I couldn't do, like a slide board?
Right.
It
was probably, it was 2014.
2014, yeah. I couldn't.
He got his peg tube in 2013. 13, right. And then I would say 2014, the other things were shifting to where it was getting more and more of the 24/7. And we implemented the Hoya lift.
As a safety precaution.
Yeah.
Because a lot of times she was trying to transfer me by herself. And using a slide board to a transfer chair became unsafe.
Mm-hmm. Right. And you're a pretty big guy, so.
Yeah, I'm Yeah,
you can only say scoot, scoot, scoot so much.
Yeah, I can only,
when you're
only
helping.
Pull me so much. And, right. And but yeah, I'm 6'1", and I weigh about 225 pounds. Mm-hmm. So I was a little bit smaller then, but not much. I did lose some weight after being diagnosed, a pretty rapid weight loss. But with Lisa's help, she and the doctor's insistence, she kept my weight up, mm-hmm. Which is difficult. I felt like I was eating too much, but...
So, Lisa, when did you start as far as this? When did you first see the naturopath, and when did you start looking at maybe we should change his nutrition?
2014, the beginning of that year of starting with the soul supplements. I mean, he was already taking the supplements, but to us to get a better guideline was probably 2014. And then, you know, things were moving within that year of having to use the PEG tube and trying to figure out a good balance of something else that what the doctors were wanting us to take from the hospital aspect. I would not go there. So we were looking into what would be more nutritious, even though it was going to be out of our pocket, mm-hmm. until we finally found the supplements for his formula. We went from Liquid Hope to Kate's Farm. And also I still implemented pea-based protein through the Soul Naturals, the Complete, because that also helps. It has amino acids in it, and it's also helps with giving the nutrition for the gut healing process also. So it was a combination of what I was going to give him or gave him in his PEG tube. Before that, we were trying to blend and do our own to, you know, until he couldn't completely swallow, and then tried to blend and see what we could shove down in the PEG tube. And it just got a little bit overwhelming and ridiculous at times. But we kind of made it work until we were on the right path, of the nutrition.
So you never, used that standard formula that they try to give you?
No.
Because you have looked at the nutrition and said,
there was things on there I couldn't even read. And if I couldn't read it, I surely didn't want to drink it.
She would Google it. And she said, basically she said that, what was it? I don't know. One of them she Googled. She says, that's going to turn your stomach into like plaster of Paris. That's going to turn you're not going to take that.
No. And especially when it's going in a PEG tube, the damage it was going to be and will do to a PEG tube also.
Yeah.
So we just opted to just keep searching and searching. That's the big whole picture of this journey, besides trying to survive it the best way we know how every day, 24/7, is just keep searching to see what else is out there, doing our own homework, doing our research, sharing with others. I'm really big on, if someone calls me and asks me a question, I'm like, no question is a dumb question. Just ask me, and I'll either have the answer or I'll try to find the answer, or just, you know, someone else might know the answer if I don't have it, because we don't know everything, because this disease is so big.
She formed a great network during that time of other people that were going through different, at different stages of the disease. Some that we could help, she could help out, and others that could help us out, mm-hmm. and had been like, no, don't take that. That's horrible for you. Mm-hmm. Do this, do that. And, you know, so I think it was a village. We had a village of ALS people, and we still have that. Lisa's still on the phone at least an hour a day talking to pals from all over the world, and I think you need that to, you know, if you isolate yourself, then you're going to just end up listening to nothing against the doctors. I've had some wonderful MDs, but you listen to everything they say, and most of them don't really think out the box. They have an ALS. This is your regimented drugs that ALS patients take. And, you know, we'll be here for you. Good luck kind of deal. And so she didn't accept that. She's like, we're going to do whatever. You know, neither did I. I mean, we formed a couple of organizations during that time, and Never Surrender became our motto. And that was Lisa's motto every day. We're not giving up, and we're not giving up on the research. We're going to research something till we find something that's going to work. You know,
Always ask questions.
Always asking questions. Yeah.
And it's the way that we've been able to move through this journey. And when people ask me, what do? I just tell them what I would do for us. Yeah. Because I'm not one to go and tell someone else what to do, because it may not work for them. It might not be their fit or their pattern that they can go down in that journey. But I would say, this is what I would do for us. You do your own homework and your own research. And this is what has helped, and this is what hasn't helped for us. And it, you just don't pinpoint and stay with one thing, because there's so many ways to try to get around to work best for each person.
Yeah, I think, Patricia, she didn't want to come off as being, you know, this is the only way to do it. This is the way we do it.
Yeah.
Now, you can do it the way we do it, but, you know, there's other ways to do it. But this is what we're doing. And she didn't want to lead people. You know, she was leery about leading people too down the wrong path. Because we were living it, and we surely didn't want other people to get worse or whatever. You know, but this is what we were doing. It may or may not, you know, may or may not work for you, but. She always led with that. I remember that. And she still does that today.
Yeah. What I find is interesting is that, Lisa, you saying instinctively, and plus because of your education and background, you're saying, wait a minute, we don't want to put this in his stomach. I want to give him as much nutrition as possible. That's logical. And then on your side, Mark, even though you were getting worse, there was something there that you felt. You said your hair and nails were better. You kind of felt that it was helping, even though your ALS symptoms were getting worse.
Right.
So that, you know, a lot of people will give up at that point. We'll say, I'm getting worse, this isn't working.
Right.
So what was it inside of you that said, you know, I'm going to keep taking this. I'm going to continue to go the natural route.
Well, you know, on just a quality of living, even though I was getting worse, I actually had a little more energy. You know, I felt, I had ALS, I was getting worse, but I felt healthier, if that makes sense.
Okay, well, that's a big deal.
I felt I was getting better nutrition, where I was losing weight pretty fast before. I was maintaining and actually gaining weight. So, and it was all with good stuff. So, you know, I had muscles, I had PTs, OTs, all these people coming in and out, and they were even amazed at, wow, how often do you cut your hair? And Lisa's like, bi-weekly. That's how fast my hair was growing. So that told me that my body was responding very positively to what she was giving me. Yeah, maybe not helping with the ALS, but, you know, overall, I was healthier. You know, my digestive system was healthier, which is where she started from the root. That was the base, is trying to heal my gut. And
okay, so this went on, you went on a peg originally in 13, but then you were pretty dependent on it by 14.
Yes.
Okay, so this is 3 years after diagnosis, you're dependent on a peg tube, you can't really swallow on your own at this point, you're in a wheelchair, and you're using a Hoyer lift.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you were pretty much dependent at this point.
Yeah,
for your breathing. Now, what point did you go on a vent?
Well, they watched my breathing for quite a while because I was stubbornly hesitant about, you know, I didn't want to be a burden to Lisa, but even more though than I was already, it seemed like, even though she'd tell me every day. And a lot of pals deal with that. You know, I mean, there's a small percentage of pals that get a trach, and I've since been an advocate, choose life. You know, because you never, things that are coming down the line, you know, you never know. And if you don't choose life, then you don't get a chance to do that. So we did a lot of praying, and my vital capacity was dropping. I was put on a mask 24/7 full time. And even though my O2 sats were kind of hanging in, my CO2 started rising. And at that point, we had to make a decision, like they said, within the next couple of months. You need to make a decision whether you need to have a trach. And, you know, if you decide to have one, it's probably better to not do it on an emergency basis and have a trach done by somebody in emergency surgery, have it scheduled and have it done by a professional. So after a lot of praying and then, you know, writing down the positives and negatives, which, you know, I mean, I you know, choose life. I wanted to be able to be with my wife and grandkids and, you know, and I saw some things beginning to happening then, and I'm like, give myself a chance to even be around. So on, in August 15th of 2015, I was traked, and, it was pretty dramatic. I didn't realize how bad, because at that time I was sleeping. Before that, I was sleeping like 20 to 24 hours a day. And after getting a trach, it was like, wow, a breath of fresh air, a breath of some life, okay? So the first couple of weeks we had to adapt to that. But Lisa's, she was trained, and she trained, you know, other family members exactly what to do. And, you know, we had a few, I don't call them crisis, but basically logistical things with getting the right supplies, but she adapted, and wow, next thing you know, I'm breathing, you know, and I'm like, wow, my brain is working again. Because when you get to a point where you need a trach, I think you need a family member or somebody there to be with you, because your brain is kind of cloudy, and sometimes maybe you can make a bad choice. So that's why I tell people to, between you, God, and, you know, your significant other and family, I think everybody needs to be involved in that. So, because thinking that you're a burden, a lot of people thinking you're a burden, once you get your caregivers, future caregivers, that's going to take care of you for that, and then have them say, you'll never be a burden, we're going to take care of you, is really kind of a relieving thing, that letting you know that, okay, I'll go on and do this. No, because once you get a trach, that's kind of reversing the natural course of the ALS, and you could live for years with a trach. So, you know, there's a lot of unknowns getting a trach. You know, you're going, now you're just leaving this path of ALS and how you decline and you pass away. Well, you're extending life unnaturally, what the doctors claim. And we even had a pulmonologist that at the time, he was a great guy, but he suggests, he didn't like the trach. So he thought that by changing the trach was changing the natural course of the disease. We didn't listen to him, thank goodness.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, Lisa, how did you deal with the caregivers? Because you're working all this time, right? Did you ever stop work?
It was a schedule. It was that you had to schedule to be able to do your schedule. We had to hire someone to come in and help us. She was there. Not as much as I was there, but she relieved me, and then also relieved Mark's daughters would come in, friends would come and help his mom and dad. So it was a team effort, teamwork.
Didn't want to put all the burden when Lisa was gone, or even when Lisa was there. I mean, there was times that we had the lady that we used, the young lady that we used, she'd stay some time when Lisa was there to try to help out, to take the burden off. And so I don't know how she did it, quite frankly. I was just, at that point, you know, I had banked my voice previous when I could talk. I had banked my voice, and at that point I had the Toby, and I was using eye gaze. And so it was just amazed at all the things that she would do, and kind of frustrated that I couldn't help more. But then I had to pray the Lord, let that go, and, you know, she reassured me that everything was going to be.
I would prepare everything basically before I left, because I'd be gone like 3 days at a time. Yeah. And have everyone just on that schedule of knowing, okay, you do this, this, and this on a daily basis, and this is when he gets this, this, and this. Unless he, you know, is not ready to eat or be peg tube fed, or, you know, you kind of, you have the schedule, but you have it to where it's flexible also. Because there's times he might be sleeping that we wouldn't, you know, wake him up to do certain things. But then there was times that he really needed certain things to happen, so you had to wake him up. Yeah. You know, and then, you know, ALS, you never know if it's a night, a good night of sleep or a bad night, and whatever happens, it would roll over to the next day. So it was always one day at a time. But everyone was on board as far as they knew when I left, they went by the schedule. And then when I got back, I took over and I went from there to however long whatever needed to be done and processed then until the next round of who else was coming in to take over.
I think things got a little bit easier, and maybe Lisa can confirm this, when I went to a kangaroo pump at night and all my feedings were all night. So that freed up today to just do the whatever.
A little minimum.
The crushing of the whatever, giving me the water. And it was less bolus feeding at that point.
Yeah.
More just like, you know, they would crush and dissolve and she'd let it set all the medications and she would give me the medicines and the, I say medicines, a lot of the supplements.
It was mostly supplements.
Mostly supplements.
I would open up the capsules and put them in.
Yeah.
Make a huge, like his own medicine supplement cocktail and, you know, liquids and so forth. And so that would be part of the protocol of him getting his supplements and medicines.
Yeah. So night feeding, I tell people about feedings and they're like, well, we can't get in. And we'll talk about this, you know, a little bit more. But when they say, well, I can't get in this supplement that you want to take, I'm like, well, why aren't you on a kangaroo pump or some pump like that? And then you have your day open to take your supplements properly, whether they need to be on an empty stomach or whatever. You can eat all night, and really you don't get that hungry during the day at all. At least I didn't.
Okay. Wow. That's amazing. So this went on 2014, 2015, 2016. You were pretty much completely dependent.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And how did you get, were you bored during your days or how were you doing? Because you couldn't speak, especially towards the end. You could not, your ability to speak was really limited.
This is when God stepped in. Big day. And he's always been a part of my life, but he really stepped in this time because I was having anxiety because, it's like I can't do, and you can only watch so much TV that I get bored of TV. So I always loved music. We had a lot of music playing in the house, relaxing music, smooth jazz. I used to love smooth jazz, even though Lisa, and I could control it with my computer. So, that's typically, you know, our thing. She'd tip me, oh, God, you blow me out because her ears are more sensitive than mine. But that helped me, music calm me down, actually, just getting into the music and then listening to the Bible because they have Bible apps that you can listen to. You know, we went through the whole Bible listening to, the Bible app. And so those kind of things and, you know, because I was an electrical engineer for almost 30 years and had to shift my thinking really. Cause if I was an analytical thinking like an engineer, I would have drove myself crazy at that time, thinking about every little thing that could have happened, you know, but I didn't, I shifted to more, and actually did a speech. My cousin was the machine talk, but I mean, I typed it in to a class at LSU about adaptive thinking and how you have to, in certain situations, you have to change from analytical thinking to a more philosophical and theological thinking. Otherwise, you'd go bats, you'd lose your mind. So, and that's what happened. I found myself, I tried not to analyze everything and tried to more of like, from a theological standpoint, trying to find peace. And I did. And I also found that my thing then, besides the never surrender, I'm like I would tell Lisa, with faith, love, and hope, we're going to get through this. And wow. She agreed.
That's amazing. Now, did you help Lisa? Lisa was doing all this nutritional research. Do you help her at all do nutritional research?
I do. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So you do. And you did back then as well?
A lot of the time was Googling things. Yeah,
still does. All of a sudden, I'm like, okay, what now?
Yeah. Oh, no. I Google this and, okay. I think we need to add omega-7 to the sea buckhorn, not the fish. You know, she always gave me plant-based stuff because she didn't want to introduce mercury to my diet by eating fish. So, and still do. I mean, I probably spend 3 or 4 hours, with the machine Googling things, different things. Yeah, not always nutritional, and I'd humorous things too on YouTube, whatever, just to occupy my time. And, uh, But by doing that, we actually found some really, you know, really interesting. And at that time, that's when I got in touch with Dr. Bedlack, Richard Bedlack. And he actually suggested, he was doing a clinical trial, or not a trial, a study through his ALS Untangled, because I had been to Washington. We went to Washington, D.C. as an ALS advocate. And that's where we met Dr. Bedlack for the first time. And I sat through some of his seminars, and I started Googling a lot and went on to his ALS Untangle. And that's where we first started taking the L-Serene, starting in 2016, because it was a recommendation from Dr. Bedlack.
It was a real team effort as far as research,
team effort, absolutely.
As far as what your protocol was going to be. You both really worked together on it.
Yeah, after her and I talked about it, we found out where we would get it from, a local apothecary that get the pure L-Serene, and Lisa initiated that, and then we had a monthly shipment that came in, and so that was our initial into the, to kind of going away from just the sole products and the shakes and stuff, until, okay, now we're going to try this amino acid that a doctor has said that, you know, could possibly help, that along with coconut oils and all kind of different things. And so, yeah, we were constantly experimenting. And at this point, because I was trached and I wanted to get better, I surely didn't, you know, my whole reason of getting a trach was not to live like this forever. That was my hope and prayers. And so by us studying together and investigating together, we found that, okay, there's things that we can do, and we get the L-Serene, and then my liver enzymes are getting bad, so I got off of riazole, which they were telling me, no, you should never get off of. Well, it was killing my liver. I was turning yellow. So she started to adapt to everything natural, no pharmaceuticals, and I started feeling a lot better.
Okay, yeah. So when did you go off your pharmaceuticals?
You still take a few pharmaceuticals.
I still take a little baclofen.
Yeah. But there was a long list.
Now it's not as long of a list.
Two. Of certain things that, yeah, the doctors still have him on and watching and recommend.
Yeah. Okay, so you're taking baclofen as a one pharmaceutical, and what's the other one you're still on?
Well, I take to sleep at night, I take the dissolvable clonazepam. And that helps me sleep, even though Lisa gives me, melatonin and some other things. Rather than, you know, that's the thing I really kind of cling to try to, because if I was not, I kind of got my nights and days mixed up. When you're not moving around or not doing anything, your energy is with vesiculate. At that point, I had no vesiculation muscles anymore, or just atrophy. I would take naps. I didn't know. I got my nights and days mixed up like a baby. But the clonopan, when they introduced that actually, I could sleep at night and stay, because I could sleep good at night, and I'm more awake during the day. Because Louisiana is not a, and that's where we live, is not a medical marijuana state. I didn't have that option. We moved to Florida. Things are a bit different. So now I take a liquid tincture, indica, 9-pound hammer, and it does just what the name says it does. It knocks me out. So, and I sleep fairly well, without going with all these pharmaceuticals.
Okay, so this went on, and then the next thing that you found, so you're continuing to tweak and, you know, play around, but you pretty much, it sounds like you're stable at this point. You've got a trach. You can't speak, you can't eat, you can't move. So not too much changes on the physical level, right? Yeah. You're just kind of sitting there, but you're not able to do anything.
Yeah. What's
the next thing that happened in this?
Well, during that time, I think the focus during that time, the PT and OT, they were just trying to keep stretching, keep you know, the atrophy to them. Even though I was still atrophy, they tried to keep me as limber as possible. Splints and all these things to keep my – had all these things on my feet to keep my feet from, and my toes from curling, and But I still had a lot of therapy. It seemed like they were there every day.
Well, he did, but it was also his doctor recommended it. Yeah. Because a lot of the home health that we have found, they only go to a certain cutoff point, I guess you could say, between their medical reasons of insurances and so forth, and ALS definition and so forth. So they had their own way, and then we had our own way with his doctors, because his doctor says he has ALS and he should still get these. And yeah. She even looked it up to know, okay, we're still going to write this prescription, and they need to come out and give him the therapies and the modalities that he needs, if it is just stretching and so forth. And so our doctor really helped us really well of staying on top of it for us, because there was a lot of times I was having to do all these schedules, and this one wouldn't come, and this one wouldn't come. And so she would always step up to the plate too, and she would say, that's my job. I'm going to contact that home health, and I'm going to deal with them. You have too much other stuff to do. So I finally got like, oh, all right, good. Yes. We're rolling here now. Thank you very much, Dr. Hill. She was straight on it. She said, and we're going to work with them, and they're going to work with us to make sure that, you know, we had, not only that, we had an aide that came twice a week, if possible, to help us with, yeah, decent shower baths and so forth. Yeah. So,
you know, kind of backtracking a little bit, I had this doctor, Dr. Bunny Hill, previous to doctor, and she became an MDVIP or a concierge doctor. And Lisa and I decided, well, after I got ALS, she's like, you know, was diagnosed. She's like, Mark, we're going to stay with Dr. Hill, even though it's costing us $3,600 a year, whatever it was costing us. Didn't matter, because we had her cell phone. She was an advocate. She knew the Medicare handbook. She would copy pages and send it to the home health saying, this is what it says. I don't care that y'all don't want to maintain a person. Okay. They kept saying, oh, we can't maintain you. As long as you're not improving, we can't maintain you. Well, she copied pages. And so this whole time I had therapy, which I think was a big key to keeping me, you know, keeping me limber and stretched. So, I give kudos. And Lisa does too. She just mentioned, that's why I mentioned her name. She mm-hmm. gives kudos to the doctor, who was just, wow, there every day. So, and she came to our house too. So she made house calls.
It was well worth it. You know, ALS is a very expensive disease. So to add another addition of cost to us, it was mind relief. And yeah. That's what we needed. I know a lot of people can't afford it, and some people can afford that plus some. We did what we could do to make sure, and we still do, that
we still have MDVIP.
Yeah, with this disease, to us, it's necessary. Some people can't do that, but we also see what benefits we get out of that, her being very proactive for us.
A doctor on call for 24 hours.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's get into what turned this around, because I'm looking at you now. Obviously, you're no longer on a peg tube. You're obviously walking around now. So yeah, no trach anymore. So tell us what led to the turnaround. I mean, this is the other nice thing is that you, with the peg tube, at least you're getting great nutrition because you're not eating any junk food.
That's true. she would not. Well, occasionally she would give me a little taste of a hamburger and put it in my mouth, and then she would take it out just so I could get a taste.
When he was pegged to.
When I was pegged to, straight. Yeah. So, but you know, even with that, she had to be careful, so I wouldn't ask for it in that, but I wanted the taste of something, but she wouldn't let me eat, of course, but, you know, and she occasionally give me some wine in my peg tube, and, you know, kind of relaxing, you know. It's good for you, Reversol and the wine. I could try to convince her. I had done my own investigation and looked, and Dr. Bedlack was doing a study on Reservoir, which is in the leaf of, on the skin of grapes.
And so resveratrol.
Resveratrol, right. So I'm convinced her that, you know, a little bit of wine in my peg every day, it's not a bad thing. So
it wasn't every day.
But she wouldn't do it every day, unfortunately, but. Yeah.
But what took place was when he started the L-serine, and within a few months, he could tell He wouldn't really say a whole lot, but he was like, Lisa, there's things happening. I can't really describe it. So we kind of went a little bit longer. And then this friend of ours that's a nurse practitioner, she's always followed Mark's journey. She lost her brother-in-law to ALS. And she's always like, okay, what are you trying now? What's going on and how are things? And so we were telling her about the L-serine. And so she says, well, you know, if one amino acid is starting to take place, she said, why not a blend? And we were like, okay, what you got? Because what she does, she would have clients come in and they would have all this energy and she'd look at their chart and it would be 80 years old and they're anti-aging looking and they've got this energy and she'd say, okay, I want what you're on. And so they introduced it to her. And so she had it to where she was able to introduce it to us. And she said, if you're taking one amino acid, what about a blend? What about turmeric? She goes, there's this product. It's got B vitamins, B12. It's got all of this and this. And we're like, okay, what you got? We'll try it. So she sent it to us. And, you know, we started out doing once a day, a scoop of it. And just trying to stay on track with what was taking place of him taking all of his supplements. We really didn't know the science behind it, but we didn't care. We were like, okay, let's try this.
Well, and so this is the Leap XX, is this right?
Yeah, she's a nurse practitioner.
Leap XX when?
He started Leap to Be Fit that comes from Leap XX.
Okay,
March 2017.
Okay.
And then, and of course he's getting PT, OT, and speech in. And, you know, I'm like, okay, within 3 months, I'm like, okay, how are you going with this?
I could swallow better. That's what I told him. I could swallow. Y'all not having to suction me as much. I could type. Y'all not having to suction me as much. I can feel that I'm able to swallow some of my saliva. And sure enough, they were not having to suction with the cannula. They weren't having to suction me as much. So
that was like 9 months on the L-serine and then 3 months that we added. So with the Leap XX, the Leap to Be Fit.
Yeah.
And then I would just keep asking him another 3 months. And in the meantime, he's got his PT helping him with his balance, OT working with his hands, because
my foot's straight.
Yeah. In the foot. Mm-hmm. So because
I can move my toes. I started moving my toes and they were moving my, I could move my fingers, you know, one and two and then, you know, and then I have some setbacks, but wasn't discouraging.
No.
Yeah.
And then, but that was, he had a goal in 8 months and we didn't even calculate the, because of him starting these products. He just had a goal because he wanted to see and be there with his daughter to get married and stand up and do the daddy daughter dance or do something and participate with the festivities and the celebration. And within 8 months after him starting the Leap to Be Fit, and it was a year past with the L-serine, he was actually able to stand up. His breathing was better. He got off his trach. He took 2 steps, gave his daughter away. Yeah. We got him back in the chair, got the trach, the vent back on him, and she got married.
Basically held my breath, but that's okay.
It's
okay. But my whole goal, and I worked for this for months with my PT, and we even attempted to do a dance, but that wasn't a good idea. But he said, him, two guys dance, and he was going to do that with me to even sway a little bit.
But just
to get a couple of steps, so I could say I walked her down the aisle.
Right.
And that was a goal. That was a goal in my mind. And and we worked on that every day. Mm-hmm. And David, you know, if you watch this, man, you're amazing. So,
he did that. And he actually did the daughter daddy dance. We got him up again
for about a minute
to stand and do the sway that he had been practicing and waiting to do.
That wasn't a good thing. I fell back in the chair, but that's okay.
So that was the end of 2017 that we actually, we visualized, okay, things have really come, you know, better in a sense.
Oh, yeah.
And then
I was still on a trach 24/7. I could get off of it. I basically hold my breath. I mean, really, I wasn't. I mean, if I got off of it more than a couple of minutes, my O2 sats would start dropping.
Right.
So But hey, I couldn't do that before. I mean, I had no control of that. So that was a positive thing. I began to start driving my wheelchair, which that was a really great thing. I could drive my wheelchair with my right hand. So it became, I felt like I was a lot more independent. I was really happy at that point, not knowing what was to come. I was really like, okay, if this is where I'm at and I can live like this and be happy, but deep in my mind, I'm like, but I think I could go further. I mean, if I've come this far, I can go further. And I prayed about it every night and every day, and Lisa and I prayed together. And then we made a big decision to move to, in December of 2017, to move to Florida, close to our friend that's a nurse practitioner. And unbeknown to us, we have actually moved closer to the factory where they made Leap. And we got to, and our nurse practitioner friend introduced us to the man that formulated the Leap, and he was he quickly corrected the way I was taking Leap, because I was taking, not only was I not taking enough, and I was still improving, but I wasn't like, you know, he said, it's great that you're improving, but you're not taking, I think if you take it properly, 2 scoops a day on an empty stomach, he said, I think things will, you know, will help you even more. And so we're like, okay, we're open. Because I had kind of plateaued at that point. I got to a point where I'd, you know, at my daughter's wedding, that was great. That was December the 8th, 2017. Mm-hmm. And, but I wasn't getting any better after that. But I was, at that point, I was pretty happy, because going from being in a vegetative state to that, to me, was a positive, a great thing. And also at that time, Dr. Richard Bedlack had started reviewing my case and for the ALS reversal, but he has to review you for a while, because short-term ALS reversals are not uncommon, so he says. And so he had started reviewing my case at that point. And we moved to Florida in December of 2017, and we started taking the protocol right, the Leap to be fit correctly. Within 3 months, that plateau.
We moved here December, and he changed it to start taking it in March.
March, yes.
With the 2 scoops. And that was a year after being on it with 1 scoop a day.
Yeah.
Right. So you took it, not only did you take 2 scoops instead of one, you also started taking it on an empty stomach.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes. Very
and then and waiting a half an hour. So like 3 hours before and about a half an hour after
First thing in the morning, this way, because we hit a lot of pals that call us on the proper way, even though Lisa's written it down, and she's actually done a video that we share with pals that she shows how to make it, and she goes through all the instructions. But if it's first thing in the morning before you eat, and you can take the Leap and 30 minutes later, you can eat. So it's not like you have to wait a long period of time. But then as the day goes on, if you eat, let's say at, you know, lunch at 1 o'clock, you need to wait 3 hours to 4 o'clock to take your Leap again. And then 30 minutes after is you can eat again. So it's really not, I don't think it's that bad.
It's just something that we found that worked for us.
That's right.
It's not me telling someone how to do, because each person's different, especially with what their challenges are of feeding and medicines and everything for each pal. Yeah. So what worked for us, it's just a guideline of someone to make it, implement it into their schedule.
Yeah.
But ours was get up. The first thing I do is I mix the Leap up. He gets that. 30 minutes later, he's getting his other supplements and his medicine. And then 30 minutes after that, depending on if he's ready for whatever he's going to have, whether it's a shake or food or whatever, mm-hmm. mealtime, if he's hungry or not, okay. And then, you know, in the afternoon, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, if he's eaten by then, I look at the clock. I watch the clock a lot. And then 3 hours later, I give him another dose of the Leap. And then 30 minutes after that, he can have whatever foods or whatever, the medicines come later. But if we go all day, we've got doctors, we've got this, we've got that. And he hasn't had Leap since early in the morning. And if he ate at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, just because of what our crazy schedule was that day, I look at the clock and it's 3 hours later still before I give him that second dose of LEAP.
Okay, so if you're really busy, he might not get a second dose till 8 p.m.
Right. Yeah, and that's okay. It's work, but it's not like a daily basis that we do that. But some people do. They do the morning and they do the night. It's each person's own way through this journey of what works for them.
And is that made a dramatic?
Scientifically, what the scientist explained to you was that it was more absorbable on an empty stomach.
Exactly. Well, it's getting that nutrition in on that empty stomach and trying to absorb as much of that nutrition as possible.
Because the food will kind of interfere with the absorption.
It's like a battle. You've got all this stuff going on in that gut, which already the gut has a bunch of issues anyway. So getting it in on an empty stomach, it makes it a lot better for, you know, easier.
I think formally what the formulator told me, told us was that when you eat proteins, your body releases certain enzymes in your body to digest those enzymes. I mean, if it's chicken, whatever, you can only absorb certain amino acids. If you absorb all the amino acids, you start growing feathers like a chicken. So your body has to discern which amino acid that it wants and which it doesn't. So your body is a really amazing piece of equipment. So it has to discern what you digested, what enzymes it has to put out to be able to digest that properly. Well, if you're taking the amino acid supplement and your body chemistry and you've eaten, your body chemistry is different than what it would be on an empty stomach. So it's already having to, you know, issues. Okay, well, what enzymes what amino acids do I absorb and which ones do I discard? So you end up, if you take the leap to be fit with food, you end up wasting most of it or a portion of it. So by taking on an empty stomach, your body's like, oh, great, this is just amino acids. I know how to do this. Oh, this is human amino acids. It's not chicken or something else, or beef. So I can absorb this readily.
Okay.
That makes sense.
So March of 2018 is when you added the second scoop and started taking it on an empty stomach. And then you noticed, how long did it take before you noticed something? Because you were in a plateau at that point.
We kind of got an aha moment, I guess you could say, because things started happening. Mark was having some infections. He was going in and out of the hospital. And so in May, he was in the hospital, and they always do an assessment. He was in ICU. And then a couple of months later, we went to the same hospital. And, of course, the night nurse remembers us because of
ICU
everything
nurse.
That we bring with us as far as the wheelchair and you got suctions and you got all this stuff. She remembers us and she was like, okay, you guys, what are you guys doing? Because she was doing her assessment and Mark was helping move around more. She was feeling the tone. She said, he's toned. What is going on?
When you get in ICU, you know, they make you get naked, right? And they do an assessment. And she was comparing in her mind for where I was before and where I am now. She's like, what are you doing? You have muscles. You're moving. What are you doing?
Right. As sick as he was because he had infections and fevers and all this other, you know, stuff, Pseudomonas, but with the trach and all of that going on. And that was like a 4-month period by the second time we were in the hospital that we were like, oh, okay. Now we really are seeing some sort of other results. And it's coming from a nurse. And so that's when we got an aha moment of things starting to look on the better end. And then in the meantime, in and out of the hospitals, we still had PT, we still had OT, we still had speech. People were still working with him. So they were helping with those muscles to tone up more so.
They started noticing a difference too.
Yeah.
Big difference.
So
they're
that
like,
was
wow.
Midsummer of 2018, and we just kept doing the same regimen of what we had been doing. You know, life goes on. You just day by day, just keep up what you're doing, I guess you could say in that sense. And then we had started going to see the ALS clinic, which was a new clinic for us here in Fort Lauderdale, Phil Smith Neuro at Holy Cross. And we met up with them. They went over all of Mark's material. They had to gather it and everything. And with that was like May we started there, and by July we saw them again, and they even kind of saw a difference.
Major difference.
And then by September, he started doing it's a strength test with Atlas. The Atlas machine.
ATLIS.
And he was one of the first ones to try it out, and they saw a difference even in a few months of what was taking place. And they were, you know, testing his forced vital capacity, the Atlas machine, and then so forth, and breathing started getting better. Everything, his strength, just throughout all the way to the fall, when they were actually, the neurologist was saying, we need to get this trach out. Have y'all thought about that? I mean, what are your thoughts on this? Because
my breathing has gotten a lot better.
A lot better.
And by doing this Atlas machine, you know, a lot of people that would watch this video would know during going to a neurologist, they make you push against your hand, his hand, and it's really subjective as to, okay, I feel a little bit more strength. Well, they see lots of ALS patients. So this Atlas machine actually gives them empirical data on the strength. So it's not like, you know, subjective, somebody holding your, they can see the numbers can rise on a graph. And my forced vital capacity was increasing. There were some issues when they checked it with the trach. I mean, because initially it got to a low of 8 in August of 2015. And it was like, you know, in the 60s and 70s range, going steady, going up. And they're like, wow, this is, you know, this is amazing. And then the doctor was like a little bit skeptical. He even did another EMG to confirm that I do still have ALS. And to this day, he did another one recently. I still have ALS, but as he said, you've improved. And so, so we just continued that process for the next year, you know, going to the ALS clinic, continuing with the therapies, which I still am doing therapy. I still do therapy twice a week. They don't come to the house anymore. I go to the clinic, the clinic, and they have all the neuro people that work with me twice a week now. It used to be 3 times a week. It's only twice.
But so when did you go off your trach, and when did they remove your feeding tube?
Well, the first big thing that happened was me taking steps, you know, going from out of the wheelchair to actually walking. You know, first, you know, after my daughter's wedding in 17, you know, that was just a couple of steps, but I still wasn't walking. That was just a shuffle. But as 2018 progressed and you know, wow, the therapists are like, are you getting strength? And like, okay, well, they got permission from the doctor. Okay, well, let's just get him up. And they hooked the belt to me and they were holding me up and, you know, put weight on me. And it was difficult at the beginning. Yes. And, but we just kept powering through it. And next thing you know, I have a walker and we're outside. We have on our condo, we have a place where I can walk, and they had me walking. Well, initially it started inside. I'm still hooked to my trach during this time.
Right, and you're still on a feeding tube at this point.
I was still on a feeding tube.
And again, just to be, I want to make it very clear for anyone who's listening that this was not normal feeding tube feeding. You first started with Liquid Hope, which is a completely organic, all natural product, and then you moved over to Kate's Farm, which is also another organic, all natural feeding tube supplement. Yeah. So I think that it's very important to understand that this is not your standard feeding tube formula that they give you, that you were using. And because there, when I look at those ingredients, like 3 of the first 5 ingredients are sugar.
Right.
So obviously that's not what you were getting.
No, not at all. And so continue to get better and better. And they're measuring all of this and then I guess 18 was just a year of getting
right. Because we started implementing his swallowing was getting better too, because he was working with the speech therapist and we were doing everything to make sure that he wouldn't aspirate too, but he was able to start swallowing again.
Yeah.
So he was able to actually start, we weren't using the feeding tube as much in 2018.
No,
he was starting to use soft foods at first, and then would step up,
nectar thickness.
You know, so it was like we went from one way into another wave of that area that he was not doing anything for himself 24/7, and then we had to transition out of that to being back to the way he was before.
Yeah,
if that makes sense.
It's not completely, like but start. Getting there.
Yeah,
it's pretty much restricted. So, you know, I want to skip a little bit, but even when you started the diet and slowly but surely he's starting to eat more and more real food, even when the feeding tube is there, what was his diet like? I assume you didn't let him go to McDonald's.
No.
No.
And eat junk food, right?
No. But, you know, there were some things that I would be, you know, we're from Louisiana and they got some good food there. Yeah. So, you know, it'd be like, I haven't had crawfish in a long time. So I was like, okay.
That was my first big meal.
But we're going to go slow with that, you know. And he says I sound like a train because I'm always like, and still to this day, chew, chew, chew. That is my big thing is chew, chew, chew. Because, you know, even though a normal person is supposed to do the chew, 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 it's like, okay, can I finally swallow? And I'm like, yes.
I did have a few spells where I aspirated stuff, but by that point, I had more of a cough. Even though we did have a cough assist, I had a cough assist. Fortunately, I was able to get up when I aspirated. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it would have been another hurdle to go over. But and that's why she said, you know, Mark, because sometimes I was beginning to feel better, and I forgot that, okay.
We've come too far
to go backwards. That's what she would tell me.
We still have to stay in our lane.
Yeah.
But so tell me what you did not eat. And to this day, you still don't eat.
I try to stay away from dairy products in general. For one, I found out during this process, I don't metabolize dairy products. Not that I'm allergic to anything. I just don't metabolize them that great. I used to drink Diet Cokes and things that were horrible for you. Well, I haven't had a soda, and I can't remember the last time, or don't have anything with any kind of artificial sweetener. No artificial sweeteners.
Dairy is the huge one. I mean, dairy isn't so much. I mean, even to the point of certain things that you cook. You know, you have to substitute to a certain extent instead of, you know, using a certain oil instead of butter. So dairy is a huge one.
Yeah, and try as much as, I mean, you know, I'm not always perfect with this, but we try to do a gluten-free too, because gluten is, after I've done my investigation, gluten is not good for your body. So occasionally I will have a roll.
But we still do protein shakes as far as he does the heel on the meal. And the soul complete, because it is very good for the gut system.
So I for the longest time I did Kate's Farm, even though I could swallow, because I like the chocolate Kate's Farm. So that was my, even though I was substituting, it was a way I could get my chocolate fixed, but yet with Kate's Farm. Right. And I was substituting food, but I was being very, trying to, at Lisa's insistence, sometime, you know, my foolishness not to chew stuff enough. But I substituted food, but I think the majority of my diet for quite a while was the Kate's food. I would drink the Kate's food.
Yeah, especially when I was transitioning into the way that things are now, you know. It was baby steps. He was starting to be able to walk. He was starting to be able to breathe on his own and, you know, not having to use his peg tube. So there was a lot of starting over things that we had that we didn't get to do for a while.
It's amazing. Had to learn how to swallow again, because your body, after not using those muscles have to be built back up. It's like they don't know what they're supposed to do. So, even the beginning of swallowing was a challenge, but
I'm impressed because you didn't swallow for 3 years, right. And the fact that your body was able to build those muscles back, and now you can swallow normally, that's very impressive. At least to me, I'm like, wow.
The same thing with the breathing. The breathing was all here, So he had to learn how to breathe in his nose and his mouth again before they would actually take the trach out.
I couldn't.
For good.
Yeah, after I started my vital capacity get up to around 75, they're like, okay, we're going to start doing breathing exercises. Well, my body's like, no, this is not the way you breathe. So it's like the air wouldn't come in and out of my nose and mouth, even though my diaphragm was pulling. So they would cap my trach during this time. And, you know, they'd have to take the cap off my trach because I could breathe in and out of my trach really, really good. And, but it was frustrating. Yes. And it took time. What happens is your soft tissue begins to collapse because the muscles are not being used and you have a very narrowed airway. So all that took time and I had to just, you know, you just have to say, hey, it's going to get better and do the exercises. I did the spirometer and all kind of little tools that they gave me. And I even had a passimeter valve. So the passimeter valve allowed me to breathe in and then blow out. And that helped open up that area. It was like, okay, now you're going to be breathing the right way. So, yeah. And then eventually I got completely, in 2019 was the year we actually met you for the first time. You know, they're like, okay, now we're working on getting rid of the trach. We're going to get rid of the PEG tube. And they got me to that. They worked me to that point, you know, over the last quarter or last 5 months of 2018 and in the beginning of 19. Right. So, and now we're getting, I had the trach removed in March of 2019.
And the PEG tube came out the same day.
Same day. March 6th. Both of them.
Wow, that's exciting.
The PEG closed. Unfortunately, the trach didn't. We found out later from our doctor that put it in, and he, ALS patients don't normally remove their trach, so he had put a permanent trach, and so they had to do surgery to close it up, which was done in May, I think.
It was June.
May or June.
It was a few months to get that appointment.
Yeah, it took a while because they're like, oh, it's going to close up. You just had it for a long time. It's going to close up. So I was walking around with it capped and breathing normal, but and then when they pulled it, I just had a bandage, a real tight bandage, so air wouldn't go in and out, but it wouldn't close up. So, but in June that year, they finally did do surgery and closed it up. And so everything since then has been fairly, you know, I'm not going to say that it's, you know, I'm 100%, but I'm like 95%, I think.
Are you able to walk right now?
I'm able to walk. I still walk with a walker.
He still has OT, PT, and speech.
They continue that every day.
He still has ALS, so it's just a different part of the journey.
That's right. And in February of this year, Dr. Richard Bedlack had enough information, and he'd been communicating with the Phil Smith Neuroscience Center, which is connected to Mass General Hospital in Boston. And he had enough information that he proclaimed me as ALS reversal number 41.
February, so that was February of 2019.
19, yeah. He watched me for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. He wanted to, you know, to make sure. And so he said he had enough data to say that I'm an official reversal. Right. So
you're eating protein. You said you try to eat mostly organic. So you're eating vegetables as well.
Yes.
And you're limiting your grains, I take it. Do you limit grains?
I do limit grains. Well, you have to if you're going to do a gluten-free diet. So,
right.
You know, she's turned me on to burgers wrapped with lettuce instead of bread.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I like bread. And occasionally I do eat a soft roll. I mean, you know, it's not a perfect diet.
Things happen.
You know, we get in a situation, we're at a restaurant and, you know, we order something and, okay, it's not perfect. You don't know exactly what you're getting. But in general, I try to, I drink a lot of cistus tea, a lot of cistus tea, and gallons of it a week, which is antimicrobial, antiviral, antifungal. The reason for that is because I still have ALS. My immune system is not, and I've gone to an allergist, and they've verified that my immune system is still not where it needs to be. And by doing things that I can to boost my immune system, I keep, you know, I've I've actually been fairly well over the past, you know, 8 months or so. I don't think I've caught anything. Tried to stay away from antibiotics because I'd taken so many antibiotics that I got to where even the infectious disease doctor started pulling me off of antibiotics because he said, Mark, you're pretty much getting resistant to everything. So we're going to run out of antibiotics to give you. So Lisa, she's done her, and she's like, okay, how can we give you something that will prevent you from getting infections and viral? And the Sisters tea, olive leaf tincture, and some things like that, which, again, the gentleman from Leap to Be Fit, just things that he's recommended. So
colloidal silver is very good.
And then you've done, and colloidal silver, yeah. So you've done your own research. You're getting ideas from different places.
Right.
I mean, that sounds great. And are you still in touch with a naturopath?
Oh, yeah.
Well, Lisa talked to her yesterday.
I talked to her yesterday.
Okay.
She's right on target of any support that we need, any questions.
So you have medical practitioners that are helping you. You've got your naturopath, then you've got also your concierge doctor.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right. And then our friend that's a nurse practitioner.
And your friend that's a nurse practitioner. So that's really helpful right there.
Yes, ma'am.
You're using these medical professionals, it sounds like, very wisely. And then you guys are making your own decisions. You're also doing your own research and bringing things to them.
Right. Oh, yeah. I mean, the ALS clinic never heard of Leap to Be Fit and didn't understand exactly what was taking place with Mark. And we kept telling them what we were doing.
But so, are you still taking coconut oil?
Do what?
Are you still taking coconut oil?
You know, for my blood type, this is from the naturopath. For my blood type, coconut is not really a good thing
for him. He's type A.
Yeah.
Okay. And so we kind of look at that also as to what we're intaking also. So we do some of the coconut oil, but not
to the magnitude I was doing before.
Right.
No.
Right. And you're still taking omegas. You're still taking
a lot of almond milk.
Probiotics, your digestive enzymes. So you're taking the Leap to Be Fit, plus you have a very clean diet, plus you're taking supplements.
Right. Yes. Yes. The supplements are very big because, you know, even though we do our best to have a clean diet, these supplements are clean. So to me, that's a part of our diet. Especially when sometimes things come our way and we're not able to do the other diet like we should. I mean, we're human. It's natural. Things happen. We get off track or whatever. But these supplements that we take is very important, and it's just part of something that I've implemented to be part of his nutrition diet.
Yeah.
Right. And I noticed you take melatonin also.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you're also taking turmeric on top of that and D3. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you've got a range of supplements, and we'll write down in the description in this video exactly what supplements you're taking, so people know that.
Yep. And essential oils are very important too. I mean, it's because of trying to make that mind and body connection. And they have healing components that are in these essential oils also.
You know, I can add that during the whole time when I was, I hate to use the word vegetative, but that's pretty much what it was, she would diffuse essential oils and calming. They had a very calming effect for me. Actually, one's called Calm. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure what's in it, but it's called Calm. Mm-hmm. Had a calming effect. And then they had one she used during the day that was a lift, that had an uplifting effect. And then they had one at night for sleeping effect. So it was always a different
balance
of smells in our house. But I think all of that was... I mean, you did ask the question, how did I get through it? I think, that helped too. My olfactory nerve was still working perfect. So all of that added to, you know, the comfort. And we still do it.
Yeah.
I have, she rubbed some on my neck this morning, actually.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
And water also, you obviously do not drink tap water.
No.
No.
Mm-mm. No.
Do not.
It's filtered.
All water is through a major filtering system in there. So, yeah. And We tried alkali water. That's my next thing that I'm actually, we've investigated and maybe putting a system in our house. And we've done that at the, looking at it through the suggestion of our, of the nurse practitioner mm-hmm. that has an alkali system in her house to maybe go more alkali. And which that's probably our next thing to do.
So you're continuing to experiment.
Absolutely. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, it's just part of it. It's not, we don't, oh, no, we're not stopping.
No.
Fantastic. And Lisa, I assume you've incorporated a lot of these changes as well to mm-hmm. your diet.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I've always been one to learn and try to learn, especially in the health way, to find the balance for me. And that's kind of where I'm at as far as, you know, you've got all the toxins that are out there. So you got to find something else that's going to balance. And that's what that keeps me going.
Yeah. Do you restrict meat at all?
Do I what?
Restrict meat at all? Or do you try to go more plant-based or you kind of?
She doesn't eat a lot of meat.
To a certain extent. I'm not a favor. It's not a favorite for me to eat meat. I mean, it's not that I'm against it. It's just, I could do without it.
And how about you, Mark?
Meat is a treat for me. I mean, you know, I grew up as a meat and potato type, you know, like most guys, I guess. At least where I'm from, you know, down south. But I don't eat near about as much meat. I mean, I get it in, the proteins I get are through the amino acids in a leap, as well as the shakes that Lisa make for me, the pea protein, the whey protein. Again, that's a dairy product. A lot of people can go, oh, I'm eating, drinking protein. Well, if you have any kind of problems with dairy, you better look away from whey protein, because that's where it is. It's a dairy product. Mm-hmm. And I was having issues with that, and that's how we found out about the dairy products. But and then try to, I'm also incorporating daily, is this, we found out actually through the Healing ALS, we met the people from Healing a Meal. I try to incorporate that into my diet too. And that actually kind of suppresses my appetite somewhat, as well as, you know, some really good nutritional value in that. And it's all natural. So it's great.
Right. And that's all organic also. Yeah.
Yeah. And what we like about it is you can add to it, because some people are like, oh, it doesn't have enough calories. Well, it all depends on your diet and what you're looking for. Right. But I mean, if you throw an avocado in there, I mean, that's good fats, but it is also, it can be high in calories. So, you know, bananas, it's other things that you can incorporate in that if you want to, but you don't have to.
She doesn't overly do it, because then I end up with too much sugar.
Yeah.
And, but, you know, adding a few things to give, adding extra calories is a good thing.
Yeah.
Right. And Healing a Meal, by the way, just so that the audience knows, it's healingameal.com, and they list all of their ingredients. They're all sourced. They're all clean sources and raw and organic, but people can get a 10% discount if they use the Healing ALS code.
Yeah, so they even
a code called Healing ALS, and then anyone who orders that can get a 10% discount, which is great. And they also donate to us, because we're working on a documentary series, and so that's really very helpful, because that is able to help us do our work as well.
That's wonderful. Yeah, that's wonderful. But it's a great product. We met the owners and a formulator that his wife had ALS.
Yeah.
And he hated what she was getting, all of the nutrition another that one. she wasn't getting, and he developed it for his wife that passed away with ALS, and he probably extended her life for mm-hmm. You know, for longer.
And kudos to him for developing this for ALS. And other people that need this type of product. But he's very dedicated and has a big heart to help others.
So
before we end this, is there anything that you want to add? Because I'm like really blown away. I'm impressed. 3 years without you on a feeding tube. You couldn't move. You couldn't swallow. You couldn't speak. And look at you now. Mm-hmm. So what is your message to people that are in your situation, they've got ALS and they're getting worse and worse, and maybe they're on that feeding tube and respirator and they can't move at this point?
Well, my whole thing is simple, right? You never lose faith, or if you don't have it, you'll find it, believe me. And you gotta just keep hope and love alive, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, the positive energy that you get from people that you love and you share, and they share with you, I think helps the healing process. And then it goes back to the motto for the companies that we have. You can't surrender, because we see pals that give up. And once you give up, that's it. Your brain is a very powerful, powerful instrument that, you know, that God gave us. And if you convince yourself that you're gonna beat this, even though sometimes I thought I was delusional for even thinking this, but if you're gonna beat this, then it's amazing what your brain can do. But by giving up and surrendering, it's amazing too how quick you'll go down. And we've seen a lot of pals that have said, you know, I'm over, and within 3 or 4 months, that's it, they're gone. And it's sad, but the brain is a very powerful tool. And
I have to add is the positivity. I mean, there's a lot of those that have given up, but there's also out there the naysayers and the negativity. And yes, that's one thing that we don't allow. If you have negativity or if you doubt, don't bring it around us.
No.
We have to draw off of each other's positivity to be able to survive this, and for others to survive this. And so, you know, we try to make the best out of each situation, no matter what, as much as we can.
Unfortunately, or fortunately, the friends we had with the negative aspects, you know, we still love them, but that's not people that are part of our life. Because we have to have, because if you have negative in your life, then it's hard for you to be really positive and stay positive. So we've made a whole lot of new friends that are very positive and that think like we do. And I think that's a big part of healing too, is being positive. You know what I mean?
And drawing off of those.
Drawing off that energy.
Mark's got a real good friend, and you know, Mark knows when his brain is not really where he knows he needs to be. All he has to do is text this one person, and next thing you know, he's got stuff coming at him, and it's like a whole different attitude. And
wow,
you know,
we can read each other's minds. So, and this is one of my old friends that he's always been positive, and now he's even more positive. Mm-hmm. So, because he's going through things in his life that we're helping each other,
right.
And so. I think that's been a big key aspect. I mean, you look at all of it, and it's not just you know, what we've done nutritionally and all that, but it's a mindset, you know, that you have to get into, that you have to just say, hey, we're going to beat this.
Yeah.
And you have to keep the hope alive and just keep fighting. Because when you give up, that's it, fortunately.
Roy, thank you so much. Now, your story is it neversurrender.com? What is exactly, what is your website? Do you have a website?
We have the Manchester Project with us, which manchesterproject.org, and that's our website.
And if anyone is wanting to read more information about the supplements that Mark takes, they can contact me, or text me, or... I don't mind sharing. That's what we're about. And then if they're do decide on, you know, taking some of the supplements that Mark takes, like the Leap XX, there is a discount code there also that they can use, Mark Mann, and it's all lowercase. And it's the only two products through this company that he takes off of there, of Leap XX. It's the Leap to Be Fit and the L-Serene. So we
right.
do want others.
Also, you take the Soul Naturals. Where do they get that? How do they find that?
It's onesoul.com/naturalrevitalization. Or they can contact me at naturalrevitalization@gmail.com if they want more information, or if they want, you know, Mark's protocol of what he takes.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
And other things, you know, just, we're here.
Yeah, we really appreciate you. I'm so impressed, and one of the things that we've actually interviewed over 20 people who have reversed ALS, and one of the things that impresses us is that you guys are always willing to share what you've done with other pals. There's no guarantee. Everyone has to find their own answers, but you willing to share what you've done, and then they go to other people, see what they've done. And our hope is that we'll have more and more and more ALS reversals.
Well, I mean, I think and feel, I call it all of the above besides LEAP, you know, either nutrition or whatever, all of the above, your faith. If I didn't have that, all of the above, that the LEAP would not be the thing that have reversed my ALS. You had to have, it's a whole combination.
It's other supplements that you're taking. It's sure. The diet to take care of your gut and your nutrition. It's the faith. It's the positive attitude.
Absolutely.
And sticking with the program.
The essential oils and sticking everything. With it.
Right.
And your faith.
Right. Right.
Lord is, I mean, you know, faith that you're going to get through this, you know, that
one day at a time. But, and that's, you know, sticking with it and doing the best you can and not giving up because, you know, I was pretty much so the one on that spot of saying, we got your medicine. We got to do this. We got to do that. If I would have skipped, I would have been right back on it, but I wouldn't skip, you know, it was always, you know, and I know Mark got tired of hearing me. Have we done medicine yet? Okay, we got to do that now before we can do something else. It's kind of like get your homework done before you can go out and play.
She was vigilant. That's okay, though.
Yeah, that's okay. With ALS, you need to be vigilant. And that's the bottom line. People don't realize, you know, yes, you can cheat a tiny bit, but if you cheat too much, it's going to be counterproductive and you're not. It's going to prevent you from...
Or if you don't take your supplements... how's your body going to work without them is the way I look at it. That's me. But, I've seen results of taking those supplements. So, doing the best we can on a daily basis.
That's right.
Yeah. There's some days
to finish this segment. I talk to a lot of people and I'm like, okay, you can tape. And we've talked about all the things above, right? All the other stuff. I'm like, you can take LEAP to be fit, but if you're not doing all the rest of the stuff, then I can't see. I mean, maybe it is, maybe it's God will that you're going to have positive results. But if you're not going the extra mile to do all this other stuff, I just can't see how just say this one product is going to help you.
Right.
Because you have to continue. And it has to be a lifestyle change. Mm-hmm. And if it's not, then if you're not willing to go that extra I'm not going to just say a million miles. If you're not extra going that, then, you know, this is probably not the path you want to take. And that's probably what you're talking about is people before we gift. You know, you can cut this out later. But before we gift, we need to make sure that these people are willing to go the extra mile.
Yeah.
We'll gift you, but hey, you gotta be all on board on everything, life. You can't just expect to eat like a, you know, horrible and live, go smoke, drink, do whatever you got to do, and then take a little LEAP and it's going to make you feel good in a couple of weeks or a couple of months. It's not going to happen. Mm-mm. So
it's a commitment. It's just part of life. And
it's a treatment, not a cure.
Right.
So
you not only take the LEAP, this is one supplement, but you have a whole foundation of supplements that you take, and none of the supplements that you take really cure or treat anything. What they do, it sounds like, is that they balance the body and help the body. They get rid of vitamin and mineral deficiencies and they help balance the body so the body can then heal itself. Is that more correct?
Yes.
That's more correct. Absolutely. Yeah. That's correct.
We've been able to find things that it works for us, for him with ALS or just, you know, making it every day with supplements as well as the other modalities with PT, OT, the nutrition part of the foods and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, PT and OT, I'd say, is a huge, PT, OT, and all that, is a, been a huge factor in all this. Because the PT and OTs that we had were specifically people that dealt with ALS patients. And so they knew exactly what to do. I mean, you couldn't, I had a couple of, I'm not going to say they were bad PTs, but they just didn't know. No. They weren't trained. So the last PT I had, she had four other ALS patients. Mm-hmm. So she knew exactly what she watched my legs and they start vesiculating. She's like, oh, time to quit. All that kind of stuff where, you know, she was, again, she was a neuro. There's a difference between a regular, you know, PT that maybe does somebody that has a hip replacement, a knee replacement, you know, some kind of injury, or somebody's dealing with somebody with a neuromuscular disease.
Right. So good. I mean, that's really important. It's really everything together.
Yeah.
To heal the body, to give the body what it needs to heal. And you've been able to reverse your ALS because of that, which is amazing.
Right.
Yeah.
So
God is good.
And faith has made a big difference.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yes.
We just got through watching our pastor's sermon again on TV.
Yes.
They record it and we watch it. And again, in case we miss something that he said today, and then, you know, daily prayer. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Right.
And praying, my pastor had to tell me, you know, Mark, he's like, do you pray for yourself? I'm like, not really. I figure God knows what I want. He's like, not always. You need to pray for yourself. I said, I pray for my other pals and my other friends and people and this.
Pals and cows.
And he said, no, you, it's okay. You can pray for yourself too. It's not being selfish. You know, so I had to learn that too, because I never would pray for myself. I just would figure God knows what I want. I pray for other people. Mm-hmm. But he changed my mindset on that. So we have a great spiritual support system too.
Yes.
Our neighbors. God has put these wonderful neighbors next to us that, Lord, what a blessing. And when Lisa goes from here, even when she goes on trips, we didn't even need a caregiver here when I was still not doing good, because they're right there next to our neighbors. They were here all the time. I'm like, geez, so I can, whatever. They would take turns, whether it's bringing a dog out or she's feeding me or whatever needed to be done. I mean, it's like they figured it was part of their journey. They're like, God put you on our life because all our kids are grown and, you know, they're not y'all's age, but they're all gone and grown. And you know, we look at y'all as like, almost like our kids, you know.
The power of prayer is huge.
It's huge, absolutely.
Don't ever hesitate. I've learned to, it's okay to ask for help.
Yes.
And it's okay to ask others to pray for you.
Yes.
That's huge. Yeah, Mark is like, what are you doing? I said, I'm getting my prayer chain going here. I got to get my prayer warriors on this. There's nothing wrong with that. And asking for help is huge, especially as a caregiver, because your mindset is go and do. You don't think about, okay, can you come and help me do this? Or how about this part? And if it is part of the prayer, yes, but it
asking
is physically having them come and accepting their help, because just start out slow and just add to whatever you're building on for it to work for each one.
I could probably show you 150 videos that we've gotten from pals all over the world. The one that's most impressive to me is this dentist in Italy. He's well off. And he wasn't too advanced yet, but he was having trouble walking and issues like that. And his hands over this past, and he's been taking Leap now for over a year. And guess he did what you did all day. He went snow skiing and he skied.
March last year he started.
Almost a year. Yeah. Not even quite a year. And then he went snow skiing.
That's fantastic.
I'm like, Wow. Dude, I wish I could do that. But he wasn't as advanced.
Right.
Okay. But still, so when somebody, when he posts more about Leap than I think anybody does. Yeah. But the French, the Italians, there's some countries that Leap is not allowed in because of tariffs and goofy stuff. So they got we've got people that going to, that are flying here, go to South Africa and distribute it to the pals in South Africa. And we've got one guy that's not been breathing is Dion. I mean, I get pictures from his wife. He's been on a trike for 8 years. He hasn't been
ALS for 15.
ALS for 15. He's now they're showing his vent. He's not, you know how it comes up when you start a breath, it shows a little silver dollar like thing that you're yeah. You triggered a breath. He does it sometimes for about an hour. He triggers the breath and he hasn't wow. done it in years. So his wife is screaming in the background, Bernice is something. And, but I mean, I can get example after example, all of these people that are just, and does it work for everyone? No, but after getting the survey back is, I think most of it is like, cause people are just not taking it right. Or yeah. they're just not doing just due diligence, commitment. You know? You got to commit to it.
And having that, the faith to keep going and having, okay, I've got to fight this and keep moving with it.
I mean, I get
it didn't
WhatsApp.
Happen overnight for us.
No, I get WhatsApp. People taking it 2 weeks and they're like, oh, I'm getting so frustrated because this is not working.
Yeah.
I'm like, really? what do you tell people? Right. That? I'm like,
yeah, I mean, 6 months, it's interesting because we spoke to Stephen Shacklin. He said, minimum of 4 months, more like 6 months. I give everything 6 months to really see if it's working because it's all natural. You have an all natural product. Right. And if you're very deficient in something, until that deficiency is corrected, you're not going to feel anything. And right. the more deficient you are, the longer it's going to take to correct.
Right. That's right. That's exactly it.
This takes time.
Mark, what was your lowest weight?
Lowest weight was 170, 175. I was 6'2", so even though I'm shorter now a little bit. But now I'm, 50 pounds heavier, so I lost like 50 pounds. I'm kind of at my somewhat ideal weight now, I guess. But during the initial, the first year, I lost 50 pounds. And thanks to Lisa, she stopped it, or it would have continued with her, nutritional protocol and upping my calories to 3,000-4,000, whatever she upped it to, it was a lot. And then having the peg, when I went on the peg, that's when my weight really rebounded, because I was getting the right nutrition. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's been great.
Never surrender. God bless.
And hey, healing and your healingals.org is a wonderful organization. Yes. So
we thank you.
We thank you very much.
Okay. Well, thank you. All right. Good night.
Good night.